recognizing change. It feeds the fires of the fear where human love seems strange. I'm gonna rise above. I believe that love is love.
So welcome to the Equity in Evaluation series as part of the TRAIN program put on by Mass Culture. I'm Sharmalene Mendis-Millard, your host, and I'm joined by two wonderful people, Charlie Davis and Ashley Shaw. I'll begin with some introductions, and then we're going to talk about what it means to do evaluations that embed equity for different groups of people, specifically blind people and trans people, and what you should know as the arts community in Canada. So I will hand it over to Charlie first, please, to introduce yourself. And thank you so much for taking the time.
Oh, no, thank you for inviting me. So as Sharmalene said, my name is Charlie Davis. I'm a PhD candidate at Wilfrid, Laurier University in the community psychology program. So my particular field of research is doing more policy analysis. So I come at things from a very procedural focus because my research is looking at how legislation has either upheld or withheld human rights for trans people in Canada. But I also have done a lot of community organizing. So I've been, a community developer in the local trans community for the past 16 years, which I realized this year is half my life, which is seems like a big deal. So I have done a lot of consulting with, various different organizations on how to do trans inclusion in services.
What was that last bit? You've done a lot of consulting work with what kind of services?
Various different types of services, ranging from retail to municipal government and how to be more inclusive in those services.
Wonderful. And where are you coming to us from today? I'm coming from the traditional lands of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Neutral Peoples, otherwise known as Waterloo, Ontario. How about you, Charlie?
Same. I'm also coming from the Waterloo region.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Ashley, over to you.
Sure. Thanks, Sharmalene. I'm Ashley Shaw, as Sharmalene mentioned. I'm also coming from the same geographic area that Charlie and Sharmalene are in. And I'm a master's student in the community psychology program at Wilfrid Laurier University. I'm also the clinical performance and evaluation analyst for Vision Loss Rehabilitation Canada, which is the kind of predominant vision rehabilitation services provider in Canada. I study employment interventions for adults who are blind and partially sighted. And then I also work in evaluation for vision rehabilitation services at the same time. And so I've had the chance to work on a bunch of different projects. So evaluating some clinical data, but also kind of evaluating some pilot community programs and community accessibility programs and things like that. I also have done some kind of web accessibility and digital accessibility advising work and evaluation work in that space. So all of these kind of have come together over the past while. I think it's kind of what Charlie mentioned. You get involved and you start doing the work and then you kind of just start doing whatever needs to be done. You move around between different spaces, between evaluating, advocating, teaching, trying to kind of consult with other community members who have maybe similar experiences, but experiences that differ a little bit from your own. So I feel like it's been a lot of that for me.
Wonderful. Thank you. I know you both have so much experience to share, which is why I invited you. So that's great. So we'll jump right into a big question, and don't feel any pressure to answer it in the most comprehensive way. When we're thinking about equity in evaluation, what does that mean to you? So I'll go back to Charlie.
Yeah, this is definitely a big question. And I feel like I can't even answer it in one specific way. But the thing that I am thinking of, and this is going to sound like it's tangent, but I promise it's related. I was listening to a really short video that was talking about the difference between, diversity and inclusion and equity. It was saying diversity looks at who's at the table, equity would look at who's being able to speak, inclusion would be are people's voices being heard, even if they're not part of the majority, and using this analogy that if people are sitting at the table, this is what all of these various things are doing. But then decolonizing practices look at like, what is the table, who built the table, and why use a table? And I think when we talk about equity and evaluation is looking at like that more essence of like, what is the program, who's invited into the program, and why was the program created? Like, if you can't answer any of those questions, then you can't really evaluate a program. So it's being more critical about all of the intentions that are going behind a program before you can even really evaluate.
And I think you raise a good point too. And who is designing the program? Who's building that table? That's a really good point. Ashley, do you have anything to build on that?
Yeah, I think that's such a good point because it takes us a little bit, well, quite a lot actually, deeper than kind of the surface look at, you know, I've built something, I want to, you know, I've designed a program or I'm trying to meet a need. And now I want to kind of like tack equity onto the top of it, like some icing on a cake, right? Because we want to go deeper than that. And we want to look at, you know, what drives what you've created in the first place or the work that you're doing in the first place, who, you know, has power within kind of the design or the flow of your work, or who's able to make decisions, you know, whose needs are being addressed. And also just kind of what preconceived notions or biases or assumptions are built into the work that you're doing or the, you know, whatever it is that you might be trying to evaluate. And again, so that's a lot of that is very similar. I think my stance is fairly similar to Charlie's. And I think to that equitable kind of evaluation in an equitable way is sort of looking at humanity from the margins inward, as opposed to kind of starting with the majority at the center and then inviting those at the margins to come in. Because that has a bunch of, like, you know, sort of tacit assumptions associated with it. Whereas if you start at the edges and work your way in, you will allow for the greatest possible kind of embracing of participants or, you know, members or whoever it is that you're trying to work with.
Yeah, I think that's a really great point in it. And it raises the question about who is at the center and who's at the margins in our society. So if you have any thoughts on how you would explain that to people, maybe I'll let Charlie take it from here.
Yeah, I think one of the easiest or simplest ways that it has been explained to me, and this I think comes a lot from like Black feminism, is like, look at who is the most marginalized of like whatever experience you're looking at. If you can make something safer for them or something applicable to them, you're inherently going to include everyone, right? So if you look at the person who's the most minoritized or the most marginalized, and if you can get something that's inclusive of them, typically you will include everyone else. So it's kind of looking at who needs, if in the case of a program, like who needs the program the most or who would be most benefited from the program as kind of like your starting place, rather than looking at what could be the top 80% and be like, well, let's just focus on these folks instead.
Right. So if you're, so there's, it's a two-pronged thing where who is this even for? Are they even designing this? And are those people in the room? So if you're looking around the room, or who's generally participating, or who's generally in leadership positions, all of those levels, who's there when it comes to demographics? Mm-hmm. So demographically, when it comes to age, ethnicity, ability, gender, et cetera, that's basically what we're saying, right? And the people who are marginalized in our society, in Canada, for instance, so-called Canada, it's still a colonial state, really, for Indigenous people. And so the dominant views and the systems were created by Eurocentric Christian,
yes,
belief systems, right? And for those people in general. I think that's, so anyone who doesn't conform to that, and male, there's the patriarchy and the, I can't even remember all the things, but anyway, colonization and patriarchy. Go ahead.
And I think like working from that mindset, even if someone doesn't fit that demographic, like when I teach, because as a PhD student, sometimes I teach university courses, like I set up my course so that like a student who's also a solo parent with a sick kid who has learning difficulties can still feel accepted in that class and still be able to do well, like that is my starting point. And then if people need further accommodations, then I'm more than happy to, you know, accommodate them. But like, even if no one in my class like meets that demographic that has been confirmed, like that is still what I try to meet to make sure that my class is kind of inclusive for everyone else. So I think a lot of the times, especially when we talk about the trans community, is that I will hear so many times people will say like, well, it doesn't matter now because we don't have anyone who's trans, or like, we will deal with this when the issue arises. And it's like, the issue will never arise because you have made your space unsafe for people to come in. So like, always operate with that like base level, and then you're kind of like set.
Yeah, you really can kind of create these self-fulfilling prophecies when you do the sort of thing that Charlie is kind of telling you not to do. So if you're designing something and you have this mindset that we'll deal with it when we come across it or those sorts of things. The other thing that happens is if someone does show up, you know, and I use show up as kind of whatever that might mean in your space, when someone starts to kind of interact with you in your work, we can always tell when something like what we've been forgotten about. There's just all these little kind of micro and macro ways where you can tell that like, this isn't meant for you. You don't belong here. And it doesn't come from anybody, you know, well, it could, but it doesn't come from anybody standing there explicitly saying to you that you're not welcome. It's just all the little, there's a big difference to me, for example, when I have to travel for work and I have to stay in hotels, if I can read the signs in the hotels versus if I can't. If I can read the signs in the hotels, then it's like kind of an automatic signal. You know, if like for instance, if there's braille signage in the hotels or there's large raised print signage, I can function in this space. And it's the same way that it would be for print users to, you know, see signage indicating to them where they should go at an event or a venue. You know that someone has occurred to someone that you need to be able to get some directional information in this space. But the majority of spaces that I visit, physical spaces and also digital spaces often, you know, I can't navigate and I can't find any of the information I need to exist in that space because no one thought that I would show up.
I think you've shared with me in the past that you've gone to, let's say, meetings or conferences, and I'm thinking of events at museums, let's say, or art galleries where there's food and there's a whole atmosphere which, you know, adds to the experience. You've mentioned before that you've just gone hungry a lot of the times because it's very difficult to function in those spaces. So if you can elaborate a little bit more for those who are planning events so that they're aware of the types of things that are not set up for you.
Yeah, so I think the kind of core piece that we're getting at, and I'll come back to this when I kind of describe what Sharmalene's talking about, it is to use as many modalities as you can. So just as kind of Charlie's talking about, you know, creating courses where, you know, everyone's learning needs are taken into account, or where kind of less typical or less anticipated learning needs are coming into account, and how that then is able to provide a learning space for everyone. You can apply that to that principle to other situations as well, such as events. So let's say you're having, you know, some kind of a, I don't know, like Sharmalene said, I've dealt with this at kind of conferences, or it could be that you're doing some kind of a, you're having some sort of ceremony or a you know, a gallery opening or like the launch of an exhibition or whatever it might be. And what's going on in your space? So is it like a really big open space with kind of no structure to it? How are people finding where they need to go or proceeding through your space? Are they like following, you know, arrows to find something? Like, how is it that they know where the washrooms are located? Or how is it that they kind of can get a sense of what the space is like? Does it have kind of like, you know, little conversation areas of furniture off to the side? Or are people all just wandering through the exhibit hall, gradually looking at everything that's there? And the food aspect is such a cool one to think about because it's so kind of integrated into a lot of the cultural things that we do. Do you have people wandering around kind of handing out food? Do you have buffet tables and people are kind of like self-serving? Are people walking around and sort of, you know, holding little plates and like holding their drink and sort of mingling with each other? Because a lot of those spaces can be difficult for folks with a variety of disabilities to navigate. So, you know, for instance, if I'm walking around, I need to be using some kind of mobility aid. So I'm, you know, being guided by a human, or I'm being guided by my guide dog, or I'm using a cane. I don't have a lot of capacity to hold things and stand somewhere at the same time. So in order to eat comfortably, it's easier for me if I'm seated. But then, you know, depending on what kind of food is available, eating something when you have no table can be sometimes difficult if you're just kind of trying to hold your plate in the air and spear weird little vegetable hors d'oeuvres. I don't know, if I'm just having all these kind of memories that are somewhat funny and somewhat uncomfortable. Sometimes there are people will find me a chair, but it's like parked over by the wall someplace. So now I'm kind of like sitting in a corner trying to get something to eat, you know, at the end of a day at a conference. And so sometimes I just don't eat at these events. So I just kind of opt out because I don't want to kind of draw attention to, you know, my own differences, but I also don't want to draw attention to how I don't match with the space. Different people will make different choices in those situations, but it's something to consider when you're just, you know, basically just thinking about what kinds of options can you provide. And that could go towards anything. Like maybe you have some more introverted folks who would like some little conversation nooks instead of just like hanging out in a giant open cacophonous space. Like what are the noise levels like in your space? Like, is there enough lighting? I don't know, just all these, there's so many things once you get brainstorming that you could consider.
Yeah, those are great examples, Ashley. And, you know, thinking about evaluation, if you're thinking about, let's say, focus groups or having people move through a space and, you know, assess how they feel about different, let's say, exhibits or aspects, these are things to keep in mind as well, right? It's thinking about how are you expecting that people will move through a space? And I think, Charlie, you might have something to add here too, where we might anticipate how people will move through and then evaluate how they did or did not meet our expectations as an evaluation, versus having a more open-ended approach and allowing for new information to come. Do you know what I'm talking about? Can you expand on that? Where I think you've talked before about, let's say, doing evaluations of how people feel going to a doctor. How might you approach that as an evaluation?
Yeah, I think like a lot of the times when people ask me these questions, what they're really trying to get at is like, how can we ask trans people about their gender? And like sometimes I think critically looking at like, what do you actually need to know, or what do you actually want to know about certain things? And so I think the example that you're kind of getting at was when I was part of a research study, and they were asking me about my input because they wanted to do a policy analysis, and they had multiple different forms of data. But then when it came to interviews, they had like an interview guide that had nothing to do with like people's experiences in policy. Was asking them about like their experiences of their gender, like what it was like interacting with other people, like discrimination, and none of it was specific to a healthcare setting. And it was like, if you want to know about procedures in a healthcare setting, just ask people to walk you through what it's like interacting from like start to finish. It's like when people think of like trans people, it's like they get certain questions stuck in their head, and sometimes it's not at all relevant. Like the amount of times people have brought me in and be like, okay, so like, how do we, like, what theory of gender are you working within? It's like, I'm here for a play. Like, I don't, like, I don't understand what you're asking of me right now. I was helping with training for a municipal government. It was like a particular department in a municipal government, and I'm going to be very vague on. And they wanted to do some diversity training specifically around 2S LGBTQ folks. And so they had brought in a whole bunch of staff. And so most people were not queer at all. And they just decided to make all of the washrooms to be gender neutral. And so it was a whole bunch of straight cis people who now had to navigate the washrooms with no prior warning. And then the city kind of, once they heard feedback and people were like, what's going on at the washrooms? Like, what is happening? They're like, obviously we need much more work because like our staff just aren't understanding what gender neutral washrooms are. And I'm like, but you put people in very uncomfortable situations without any prior warning. Like that's not what trans inclusion is. Trans inclusion is me being able to use the washroom of my choice, not making confusion for everyone else and be like, yes, this is what trans people do. There's just like so many, I think, different ways in which it's like people don't, it's like they know that an issue could arise, but they don't know what it is. And so they plan for these like really, I don't want to say weird, but like things that aren't going to happen, and then think like that is good rather than asking questions. Like I think one of the most inclusive conferences I've ever been to wasn't one that had 100% of things thought through, but they had like designated people who had like visible markers that like if you had an issue, you could go to them. And so there was one conference I went to where there was a buffet, someone was using a cane and wasn't able to like carry the food themselves. And so they were able to go to someone and be like, hey, I need help. And so the person like walked them through the entire food table and then brought the food with them. And they ended up staying with the person and like having like a lovely conversation. Like sometimes like inclusion can be just being open for things to like come up as time goes on.
Going back to what Astu was saying, instead of you having to think through and put your, I mean, obviously it's very good to put yourself into somebody else's shoes, think through what they might experience. Yes, absolutely. But you might not be able to think of everything. And so when you're doing an evaluation, you can ask people like your doctor example, just tell me what your experience was. Okay, just walk me through getting into the building. How easy was that? How did you feel in the waiting room? How were you greeted? And just having people talk you through that, that's one. And two, I really love that idea of the ask me anything people, just having designated people around, volunteers or helpers, so that you can go to them for anything. That's really neat.
I'm going to be bold enough and say, you will not anticipate everything. That's never happened to me. I've never caught everything that could happen. I've never anticipated when evaluating all of the things that would come up. Lean into that tension. People are really uncomfortable with tension. That sounds like a goofy statement, because like of course you are, but like tension can be good, right? Because tension can create strength too. Like if you braid string, it's stronger than if you hadn't braided it, right? And there's tension involved in braiding. I'm getting poetic for a second for some reason.
I love it.
So so embrace that tension that you're not going to anticipate everything, because people will often ask me, they want like accessibility checklists, even for evaluation. They want like a checklist to make sure that their evaluation process procedures are accessible and all these sorts of things. And like, I don't have checklists when I do this. I have kind of a flexible, iterative way of doing things. And so do the people that I've seen do this kind of work really well. They're exactly like the person that Charlie's talking about at the event, who are able to kind of like think on their feet in a situation. Also just listen really, really well to what someone is telling them that they need, or maybe a problem that someone's experiencing, or could be anything depending on the situation, but they're flexible and they listen well. They don't mind being corrected. I'm trying to think, we could probably make a whole list of like characteristics, and someday I will turn these into like job postings when I'm looking for people to collect data and do these sorts of things. Cause it's really, if you're adaptable, just enter into those situations with people. So if someone finds that like their needs haven't been anticipated or they're experiencing difficulty, it's like the complete opposite of being defensive and kind of thinking that something is going to be too much work and just kind of, tensing up and shutting down, which we all are guilty of at times. And that goes for whether you're kind of, creating a program or a space, or if you're evaluating it, or if you're, that's basically just a kind of a inclusion concept in general for whatever type of work you're doing. There's no need for hiding,
and there's no need for shame. And also to be asking questions along the way and maybe spot checking things. So for instance, Charlie, you were mentioning how you'll get asked questions that have nothing to do with the thing that you actually want to know about. You know, maybe people have in their mind, oh, okay, if I'm talking to a trans person, I must ask them XYZ, which is not the case. So I'd like to think about that initial process of coming up with the evaluation questions and how you approach evaluation. So you both have touched on these things, but you know, maybe I'll start with you, Ashley. You've had a two-pronged approach to evaluation, and I wonder if you could talk about how you approach evaluation.
So I try to think of it in a really, really kind of flexible way, and I'll approach this kind of differently depending on who the stakeholders or the evaluation users are, but basically, evaluation is asking ourselves, what is it that we're doing and what is it that we want to know about what we're doing? You know, what is it that we're doing that really like sets the scope for what it is you're trying to evaluate? Is it like a whole program? Is it a specific kind of aspect of a program? Is it, you know, it could be anything, but kind of asking what you're doing and then getting yourself to kind of pinpoint those things helps you to start thinking in a helpful direction. And then what is it that you would like to know? You could literally make, and I often do make, kind of giant lists of all the things I don't know about what it is that I'm doing, about either its impact or about kind of whether the process is actually happening the way that I think it's happening or the way that it was meant to happen on paper. That could be anything as well. And I would say don't feel afraid to be really, really kind of big picture here and kind of pull in all kinds of things, because you could pick out pieces later and you can kind of prioritize, like, what do I really need to know immediately? What could wait till later? Is there a particular order? If I want to know these things, should I be knowing other things first? So for example, if I want to ask people about their experiences with some aspect of my work or my program, do I already have data that I can use to frame those questions so that when I have those people in a focus group or in, you know, sitting in front of my survey or whatever it is, I'm making respectful use of their time and their knowledge. And so I think those are kind of the principles that I like to think of in terms of starting, because it also kind of frames evaluation as this like storytelling process where, you know, you're starting off with telling the story of this is what we did, or this is what we're going to try to do. This is our pilot. This is our intervention. And then this is, you're going to start to fill in the pieces of what exactly happens as this program gets administered and who it is that's there and what they do while they're there and how they change, how their lives change, all of those interesting things.
Yeah, well said. Thank you, Ashley. How about you, Charlie?
Yeah, I really like how Ashley framed it. The one thing that I think I would add to it, and it's kind of the thing that I feel like I in like especially do, is look at what the underlying assumption of a program is. In the academic world, we would call this like the theory of change. Like, what is like the underlying assumption that you think this program is going to do? So like by, you know, doing this program, like usually it's like, if we do this program with these people, this outcome will happen, and have that kind of explicit to see whether or not that actually makes sense. I was thinking of an example of this. I was approached by a municipal government worker. I think all of my examples are going to be for municipal government. I have nothing against them. They're lovely people. But this person reached out to me. I never met them before, but they were like, I hear that you're a trans expert. I am working on a project right now where we want to essentially redesign all of the city parks within like the KW region. And that was kind of like what the job was at the time. And so they were asking me like what barriers trans people have to accessing parks. And they were asking me all these questions and I really couldn't answer them. And I was like, I was getting like not defensive, but like I was like my entire body was tensing up and I was like, I don't know how to help you. And I realized it must have been on my face because they asked me specifically, like, is this like, what are some of the barriers? Like, I'm not asking the right questions, like what is going on here? And I was like, trans people don't feel comfortable being outside. Like, if you look at the research, we don't feel comfortable in public. Like, we will never feel comfortable in any space where other humans could potentially access. So like, it has nothing to do with the space where the park is located, what the colors of the playground is. Like, it's other people that's the problem. You can't fix that. And so like any program that this person ended up creating, like, is not going to really help trans people, because that underlying assumption, like we can just, you know, renovate a park and it's more accessible to trans people, is flawed and it's not true for us. And so I think sometimes, you know, when you can have like, you know, map things out and like ask all these questions, like, does it actually make sense? And what I find also happens over time is that what your program is or what you're doing changes so dramatically, and that tends sometimes doesn't end up getting like captured. And so like at the beginning you could have like had this one particular type of program, and then over time it kind of, you know, maybe over a series of like several months, it kind of changes. And so by the time you evaluate it, you're not actually evaluating the program that you think you are. And so that causes a lot of tensions as well. I think I really love the way that like actually kind of like laid out everything of like, you know, you need to understand what you're doing, and you need to understand like what you actually need to know or want to know about what you're doing. But like, be honest and transparent by like what it is you're actually doing, and to have, if you can't, then like bring in other people to be like, this is what you're actually doing, and this is, at least from the outside, what we would perceive you are doing. Because I think that would kind of highlight a lot of some of the answers to like what you need to know.
I think if I can add something to that, one of the ways you can do that is to get different people to describe your, I'm just going to use program as the common unit here, but I know there's other units that we could be working with. But let's say you have a program and you have the kind of like on paper version, which is probably like Charlie is saying, the version that you started out with, the version that you pitched to, you know, whoever it is that helps you make that possible. You know, it looks really good. And maybe it's the pilot, like maybe you've never done it before. So maybe it's what you thought your best kind of ambitions for what you thought it would be. Then we all should kind of make our own kind of in real life, like what is happening in real life from what I can see from my own observations, you know, as someone kind of evaluating this program or this space, what's actually happening. Because, you know, I always want to know, I'll ask people, they'll tell me their spiel about what their thing's supposed to be like. And I'm like, okay, what in real life, like in a given day, like what's it like, or, you know, what's actually happening on the ground. And then kind of ask that question of other people as well. So that could be like your staff, or it could be like your volunteers, it could be your participants. And you can get this in different ways. You don't have to necessarily get it formally, you know, through certain kinds of question asking, but you can get it through kind of creating conversations about what the program means to people, or what it is that they do when they come there, or, and then you can kind of like pull all these pieces together, and you'll get this rich tapestry of, you know, what we thought would happen, what's actually happening, and the contrast of what's actually happening for different people who are present.
Both raised really, really good points. When people are thinking through an evaluation, so you think of the assumptions, you're thinking of, okay, what I think the program is, or let's say it's a performance, like an artistic performance, and that could change over time. And so when you're evaluating, let's say, an audience's reaction to it or how they felt, it's important to think, okay, what is the performance that actually, what did they actually experience versus what was planned to begin with? And then thinking about the assumptions underlying that. So that theory of change. And I like the way that you had described it, Charlie. So by doing this, the outcomes are this, or, you know, we expect this to happen. When you're designing an evaluation then, so you're thinking, okay, what is it that we're doing? And then what do we want to know? When it comes to the collecting data, there's often a step in between where some evaluators create these logic models. So you take that theory of change, you think, okay, by doing this, then these activities, then these are the outcomes that come out of it. And it usually is in a visual and a flow chart. It's not something you have to do in evaluation, but I just wanted to get both of your takes on logic models, just for those people who may not be familiar with them. And so the pros and the cons, or how you might use them.
I think logic models can be a useful tool. So when I think of times where I've done like a more traditional one, where it's like the inputs that you have, the different types of resources, I think those activities, and then those like outputs, back when I was chair of like a grassroots initiative, like I did a logic model for some of our programs, and I didn't find it helpful for like the evaluation and like what we ended up doing, but I found it helpful for realizing what I didn't know about our group. And so kind of going back to like, you know, how Ashley kind of was like talking about like what you need to know and like mapping out what I didn't know, I found it very useful for being like, I don't actually know if I could list out all of the resources that we have, or list out like all of the things that we actually do. Like there were moments where it made me pause to be like, I am the leader and I don't know the answer to these. So, and that became like an interesting, like, you know, bridging off point. But for me, like, I'm not really a visual person. And I think Ashley will speak to this a little bit more. It felt like an exercise that I was doing in class of like trying to map out something that didn't quite work with the way my brain works. I wrote everything out. So for me, the visual component wasn't necessarily helpful, but looking at those as questions and trying to answer them, being like, oh, I don't actually know the answer to this. And so like with all of these things, like the different tools that you can use, but it's more about like the utility of them. And if it doesn't work, then like, I would say kind of scrap it.
That's a really good point. Thanks, Charlie. Ashley, what's been your experience?
Charlie was talking about the logic modeling feeling like a class exercise. For me, it always reminds me of filling out like funder applications, because it's often how funding applications will work, where they want to know kind of like the activities and the inputs that you have, and then the outputs you have and the outcomes you have. And it felt like a different version of creating the budget. So, you know, you'd create the budget for the funding proposal, and then you'd create this this chart that looked kind of similar, that was, you know, really flat. It wasn't necessarily something that I found kind of entirely helpful at first. What I do find helpful about it is there's something that the logic model process is getting at. And it's getting at this important piece of looking, especially like at the activities and inputs and things like that, that you're doing. And like, why is it that you're doing them? Especially if you are in this uncomfortable position of having to logic model something that's already running. Like if you're not, you know, if it's one thing, if you're starting sort of a net new initiative, it's another thing if you're kind of working backward and trying to create a logic model for something that's already happening. And then you're trying to look at, okay, what activities and kind of resources are at play here and why? And that can give people some really exciting insights, especially if you're able to work on it with others. So if you have evaluation users or stakeholders or program staff or performers or whoever it is that's involved with you, if you're doing this as a collective exercise, it reminds people, what is it that we're trying to achieve here? Like back to that theory of change that Charlie was talking about. What is it that we want to happen? And how does that connect with what we said that we're going to do? Because there shouldn't be kind of any things that you're doing that don't have some connection to that outcome. Like you're not doing activities for the sake of doing activities. I mean, maybe you are somewhat in the arts. You have to remember I'm coming from like a space where, you know, it's like healthcare or it's social service and we're trying to do certain things in a particular way. But even, you know, you could adapt this for arts spaces, right, where you're trying to use resources effectively, and you're trying to, especially if you're trying to increase someone's access to the arts or use arts as activism or do any of these kinds of things, you want to be thinking about kind of the outcomes first and working backward to make sure that you have activities and resources and things like that that actually connect to those outcomes. And we've actually, like, I've seen people remove activities that it turned out had zero connection to what their goals were and what they wanted to achieve. Or if those activities are already in place, kind of evaluating those activities specifically to figure out, well, are they creating some outcome that we hadn't anticipated? Unanticipated outcomes are kind of so important to know, because some of them are wonderful and some of them can be really, really unfortunate. And so those might be kind of flags for you to figure out some of the things that you definitely don't know. I don't know why we're doing this particular activity is a great thing to know, right? The way that a logic model works, like in that sort of visuals or flow chart or whatever kind of capacity, and I've seen it done in all kinds of different ways, I think works well for a certain style of thinker. Might not work well, but I think you could modify the modality, I guess is what I'm thinking. So when I do logic models, because I need them to be accessible, I basically have to do them in Excel. So I just have like an X and Y axis. I can't make links between, like I can't make multiple links. So I may be able to link an activity to an outcome, but then I can't link that activity easily to other outcomes or link, you know, prior outcomes to that activity, or, you know, it's not as freeform as it could be, because I won't be able to see like arrows and things like that that people could draw on. You could do it in a totally different way. So you could do it as a story, because storytelling is sort of logic, like has a logic to it. You start with something at the beginning and, you know, like, think about like, you know, stories that you tell to kids about, like, you know, the little red hen or whatever it is. She's going to bake some bread and she goes through this whole process and her goal is to bake bread, and she does A, B, C, and D, and they're all about the bread baking. So you could like logic model that's that like goofy story about
Absolutely.
Baking, and you would get the same sort of deal, right? So it's about what kind of works for your thought process, but also like super importantly, what works for your stakeholders or your evaluation users. So for example, like I've seen people bring a beautiful freeform drawn out logic model to a room full of blind folks who are just like, yeah, okay, we don't really care about this because, you know, we want to know other things, or we don't have the capacity to spend a lot of cognitive load engaging with this visualization.
Yeah, that's a very, very good point. And, you know, I would love to see what artists and the arts community come up with different creative ways of presenting not only the logic, meaning like what are we doing and why and how, and then the so what, like the evaluation results part of it. Charlie, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think the only thing I was going to add is that, like, for me, I think the most important thing is that, like, following the flow of logic, like, do, like, as Ashley was saying, like, do your activities actually line up with outcomes? Because I think that, like, if you were to, you know, list things, and, you know, this is no shade to any place, but, like, there are probably activities that don't actually match up to anything, or things that, like, don't actually lead to the outcomes that you're hoping for. You know, I think of one time, like when we talk about diversity, you know, there are certain things that we think will be helpful, but don't actually lead to the outcomes we want. Like, so in the circles I run in, like the predominantly white spaces. And so it's like, how do we increase diversity? How do we become more inclusive? And there's always the like, we'll just invite more racialized people. And it's like, but to do what? Like, what is the activity here? Like, we just need to fulfill our quota. Like, what do you, so like looking at like, just again, like that flow of logic of like, what are you actually trying to achieve? Like, what is your activity? Like recruitment and like reaching out to like racialized people, like what is the actual activity there? And like, what is the outcome that you're hoping for? Because the outcome that you're hoping for is you're just magically like less racist. Like that's not how that's going to work. And so again, just like being a little bit more critical about some of these components.
Sometimes equity, diversity, inclusion initiatives, maybe they're just focused on the interpersonal communications or just ticking off a box, or calling out certain, like, are you supposed to be saying the right words? When really, what is it that actually will make a change for somebody's life? That could be completely different. One thing that I'd love to pick your brain about is this idea of the why we're doing evaluations. So in a situation where, yes, you want to retain funding, we were talking about doing evaluations for funders. What are the consequences of doing evaluations that are solely driven by your funding needs? Like what happens in that situation to the process, and especially who's burdened by that process? Ashley, why don't you go ahead?
I'll be kind of brief because I know that Charlie has awesome examples and cool stories about this as well. But when you're asking this question, it's making me think about earlier today, I was reading a journal article, and it was this evaluator had gone to the trouble of figuring out kind of like talking with evaluation stakeholders about what they think evaluation is, and then contrasting that with kind of how evaluation as a field kind of describes itself and its goals. And there were some really fascinating distinctions where, you know, there are people who kind of think that evaluation is like just a way to get your funding renewed. Evaluation, you know, is just a box that you have to check because your funder says you have to evaluate in some way. All of these kinds of things that kind of are experienced by some stakeholders, which is so unfortunate because evaluation is a huge opportunity if you can kind of take hold of the opportunity and run with it, right? And I think the way that you communicate what evaluation means to you as either the evaluator of a program or as like the program's manager or as like whatever your role is, the way that you communicate kind of what you think about evaluation is going to impact all of the other stakeholders. So like your colleagues and participants and sort of audiences and users and whatever it might be, like all of these people are going to be impacted by how you frame evaluation. So if you're kind of framing it as, you know, we have to do this evaluation because the government says so, for example, let's say you framed it that way. Now we're back to like Charlie's, you know, diversity quota or whatever. That's sounding like you were doing something because somebody told you to, and you're not actually engaging with it, and you're not actually interested in what the outcomes are. You're going to collect some information and pass it on to somebody else. And maybe that's wrong. Maybe you are actually interested in what the outcomes are. And maybe you are actually interested in improving and figuring out whether what you're doing is actually effective. But you're not communicating that to people when you're kind of framing evaluation in that way as like a box that you have to check off. And I've definitely worked in the past with folks who they'll think that I'm just evaluating something because our grant requires me to evaluate it, which is just missing so many kind of golden opportunities to do great work.
Thank you. Charlie.
Yeah, I think like when you get to like the burden part, like I think the burden within the trans community or the burden that's placed on the trans community is so large and it could be like a whole other conversation. But I think the ways in which evaluation is like framed really changes how people engage with it. You know, and I think like if you're given like a survey after you use like a resource or, you know, regardless of what it is, and it's like, can you please fill this out? If we get enough good feedback, like then we can continue. Like if you like hated the experience or you had a bad experience, like you're less likely to actually say that if you think the service could be beneficial overall. Like I've thought that so many times. And this is, you know, ranging from like counseling services to different like, you know, out shows I've gone to where they had really triggering stuff. And then afterwards, they're like, this was funded by whatever thing that we need to appease them. You know, we need this information. Like, can you say it was good so we can get funding next year? And I'm like, sure, it was fine. Like, it wasn't like the worst I've ever experienced. So like, sure, you can get funding next year. Like it just, how it gets framed really tells like people, like, what do you actually want to know and how much are you willing to like improve or, you know, use the feedback. I also like think about this a lot in like community programming towards like queer youth where they'll ask the parents how the program was. And it's like, I don't believe that the parents always in every case has purely accurate information about how the child went through that program, regardless if they're queer or not. Like any child, like, you know, there's the degrees of separation. Like there's, I think, trying to frame it in a way of like, we want to improve for next time, like can you let us know, and maybe have that separate from like the information the grant need to know. So for example, a lot of times funders will care about like how many people access the service, general, like was it good or bad, whereas like, you know, maybe for your own organization you want to know like more critical questions of like, how can we improve? Were things accessible? Was there anything that you would want us to know? There was one play I went to, it was part of a, I don't even know what it's called. It was like a Pride series that happened many years ago. And it was the first time I ever saw a play that had to do with trans issues. And I was very excited, but it included a lot of intimate partner violence stuff that was not in any sort of synopsis, which I found to be very triggering because it was separate from, they did a survey, but it was like a separate question that wasn't connected to anything else. It was like, is there anything you want us to know? And I was like, listen, this was very triggering. Don't ever do this again. And the next time they ran it, they had like, you know, trigger warnings on the program and they also verbally explained them. So I was like, you have done your due diligence. So like that organization, like I would now trust with anything I told them. Whereas other places, if I've given feedback and they don't acknowledge it in any way, like I've written that program off, regardless of some other factors. So I think like being transparent and being authentic is the best thing you can do in evaluation.
Yeah, that's really good. I think that transparency and authenticity to build trust are key. So what I'm hearing from you too is that Because to be equitable or to consider equity, transparency is so key. And it, you could have multiple reasons for doing an evaluation and asking these questions. I like this idea of saying, okay, these particular questions are funders, we're going to be reporting to the funders. This particular question, we actually really want to know what you're thinking. And by you answering these questions, it will not, you know, you have to, of course, go through your privacy considerations, and that's for a whole other session, but you know that it won't impact on the services that you receive, and it won't impact on our ability to get funding necessarily. So, because I think what I've heard from you before is that at the end of the day, it's to have the participant feel burdened by this, the weight of, oh, will this organization get funding or not? That's not fair, right? That's not fair at all. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think that last bit that you're talking about was kind of, you know, and that Charlie, you were talking about participants, about feeling like you had to essentially kind of be deceptive in a survey or on an evaluation question because you didn't want to, you know, impact the existence of the program. That's kind of, I think if you're kind of designing an evaluation and you've caused that to happen, it's a sort of a poor comprehension of how funding and evaluations and things like that relate to each other. And sometimes that's not even sometimes it's just kind of, that's how it has to do with how the evaluator and the program staff communicate with each other and how they understand, you know, sometimes when you go to evaluate something, staff feel like you're deciding whether you're going to cut them off or not, like whether you're going to keep their program going or not. I don't view it that way. Like I view it as if we're evaluating something, we want to know that it's effective. And if it's not effective, something else might be effective. Like we want to be able to kind of iterate, or maybe it was effective at a certain time, but some variable changed and now we need to kind of transition a little bit. Those things should not end up in translation kind of getting communicated to participants as that you need them to say some great things about a program in order for it to continue to run. Same with, and this is sort of a separate issue, but I have to bring it up, but you know, when you need, if you need like testimonials from people because your funder likes to have a good photo of, I don't know, kids finger painting or whatever it is that they might be doing, that would be cool. Like don't make people feel like you need them to kind of participate in that sort of activity in order to keep going, because that's not, you know, that's not going to make or break whether a program keeps going, right? So there's a whole bunch of variables, and but a lot of times as participants we don't know that, and so it can create, you know, stress, especially in, you know, if it's a program for kind of equity deserving groups or for groups where there's kind of scarce resourcing going available. We're sort of used to things, really great, sometimes excellent programming being suddenly like cut and disappearing, which I strongly believe is just because nobody knew how it was able to accurately kind of evaluate how effective it was.
Yeah. And I think so the scarcity of resources, that's the bigger context that people are working within, and it is too bad. And what is valued and not in our society. And that's a bigger picture. But part of the series is to give artists and the arts community the resources and just even the awareness of how to effectively talk about and evaluate or even approach an evaluation to you know, reflect upon their own work, and also to be able to write funding applications or to be able to, you know, communicate how effective their program is in different ways. I mean, it could be unanticipated ways. It could be big or small. But, you know, I think that the idea of how do you assess and communicate value, maybe that's what, like value of what to whom is the eternal question, right? It's beauty's in the eye of the beholder and all of that. It's a complicated issue.
I think like when we talk about like evaluation and like, you know, assessing like how people, you know, experience something, like especially when we're talking to like an arts council, like there's so many creative ways that you could go about this that isn't even like a survey form. I'm thinking back to the one research study that I you know, heard of, like this was like 10 years ago, where they looked at, I think it was an art museum, and they looked at where in the museum the polish on the floor was worn away, because then they could see the foot track. They can see where people were walking the most and the standing the most. And that was how they were able to tell what photos or paintings people were standing in front of the most. And that was, a peer-reviewed, published research paper. And so I think when we talk about evaluation and assessing things, there's so many creative ways that you could go about it. You could, if you're doing some sort of exhibit, you could walk with people and be I just want to are you comfortable narrating your thoughts, or going with groups of people, asking them how they're in the moment interacting with certain things. Or if they don't want to talk, you can just be hey, I'm going to give you 10 little stickers, go through the exhibit. If you're comfortable, just play out the 10 that made you think the most, or whatever, right? So there's a whole bunch of different ways that you can ask people the questions that you want. That's not a survey. And it sounds kind of weird saying this as someone who's a researcher by trade, but there's so many much more creative ways that's just not a survey. Mm-hmm. That I really want people to be creative with.
And especially this is the creative arts community. We're looking to you to show us the cool different ways of doing things. Any last thoughts for artists and the arts community in Canada when it comes to approaching evaluation and what they can keep in mind? I'll just start with Charlie.
I would say the one thing more generally is that I think sometimes when I talk in some of my circles about some of these more systemic issues, there is this assumption that art spaces are inherently more liberal and more progressive, and that some of these issues just aren't as applicable. And I would really challenge people to say that that's not the case. And so there are still ways that we have to be more inclusive, or think more about equity issues in arts and art spaces. And so I guess the one takeaway, if I could only have one, is that some of these things will need to be worked through. It's not arts being inherently more progressive.
Thanks, Charlie. Ashley?
I'm sort of coming at this from a slightly different angle, because what Charlie just said is super important, kind of not to make those assumptions about kind of the arts or artistic spaces, but do rely on any kind of core aptitudes that you or your colleagues or your partners have in terms of being creative, of sort of acknowledging kind of the different aesthetics that are present, because that's so important, that kind of understanding of different notions of beauty, or the way that the arts help us to kind of play with experience other people's version of reality, or all of those things can make a huge contribution to work around equity, inclusion, diversity and accessibility in general, but especially kind of in evaluation. Enter, I think, that evaluation space and bring all of those kind of creative and philosophical and, sort of transdisciplinary, multimodal, bring all of the things that make all of you wonderful artists and curators and performers and all these things. Bring that to the evaluation space, because it will enrich kind of the work that the rest of us are doing and building on.
Thank you so much. Those are great last words. So thank you so much, both of you, for your time. And I appreciate it. And I hope everyone found this useful and inspiring. I did.